Welcome, everyone. We begin by recalling that the set of positive integers is denoted by capital N and consists of the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. Sometimes people call it natural numbers. These are the numbers that you use for counting. The integers are denoted by capital Z, ganze Zahlen, and they consist of all positive integers together with 0, together with the negative integers. What are the rational numbers? Anyone? What is a rational number, yes?
They are also the ones that can be formed with divisions of integers.
Very good. They are all the ones that can be formed by taking fractions of integers. They are all fractions of two integers, numerator and denominator. The denominator is not allowed to be 0. For example, 5 over 9 is a rational number. Any two rational numbers you pick, divide them, you get a rational number. Any two integers, the fraction is a rational number. And there are other numbers that we'll get to. But let's look at these more closely. Question: can you enumerate the integers as a list? By this, I mean the following. Can you design a way to produce an integer every day, put it in a box, so that every integer at some point will appear in this box? Can you write an infinite list with the first element, second element, third element, fourth element, and so on, that contains all the integers? The way we have written the integers is not a single infinite list. If you put 1 the first day in the box, second day you put 2, the third day you put 3, the fourth day you put 4, then minus 2 will never show up in the box. So we have not enumerated the integers as a list. Is it possible to create such a procedure to put the integers 1 a day in a box? Yes or no? Can you write a list? Yes?
I would say yes, you can, if you start with 0 and then take 1 minus 1.
Very good, very good. Yes, you can. For example, start with 0 and then 1 minus 1, 2 minus 2, 3 minus 3, 4 minus 4, and so on. You put one integer in this box every day. Every integer, sooner or later, will appear in the box. Very good. Thank you. Notice that they're not listed in an increasing order. You cannot list them in an increasing order this way because there is no smallest integer. But you can still make an infinite list out of them. Okay, very good. We say that the set of integers is countable. Countable means you can enumerate them as an infinite list, as we have shown here. That's what we mean by countable. You can design this mental experiment where you put one integer in this box every day, and every integer appears at some point. Okay, next question. Can you do the same with the rational numbers? Can you list all the rational numbers as an infinite sequence, starting with the first element, second element, third element, fourth element, and so on, infinitely many, of course, so that every rational number appears in the list? Yes or no? Now, don't justify, just give me an intuitive answer. How many of you would make a guess that yes, that would be possible? Okay. How many would say no? About 50-50. I see, yes, it's a very controversial question. It's a very tricky question because there are plenty of rational numbers. There are so many. There are many more than the integers. Between any two rational numbers, if A and B are rational numbers, that is to say fractions of integers, between them, there are infinitely many more. If A and B are rational, you can take the midpoint, A plus B over 2. If you add A and B and divide by 2, it's again a rational number. So between any two rationals, there is another rational. Any interval contains infinitely many rationals. It will be much more difficult to put them in an infinite list. Those of you who said no, that was your intuition, probably. Okay, well, can you enumerate the rationals as a list, turns out the answer is yes. The talk today will have two takeaway messages, and this will be the first. It is possible to enumerate the rational numbers as an infinite list. Here is how we are going to do it. I will now convince you that it is possible by writing this list. I'll write several members, but I cannot fit them on one line, so I will be using several lines. First, we write these three rationals. 0 over 1, 1 over 1, minus 1 over 1. These are exactly the rational numbers that you can write by only using 0, 1, and minus 1. These are fractions that only involve 0, 1, and minus 1. Next, I'm going to put 1 half. This is the fourth element in my list. I put it on a second line, but you can imagine it's our fourth element. Now I'm putting all the rationals that also require the usage of the integer 2 in the numerator or in the denominator. Now we're getting to more complicated rational numbers that also have a 2 in the numerator or in the denominator. 1 half. After each number, I'll immediately put the negative, just as we did when we were enumerating the integers. 1 half minus 1 half. Then I'll put 2 over 1. Now 2 will jump up in the numerator. And minus 2 over 1. Are there other rational numbers that you can write by only using 1, minus 1, 2, and minus 2, and 0? No. Every other rational number would require, either in the numerator or in the denominator, an integer which is at least 3 in absolute value. So by using only 1, 0, 1, minus 1, 2, and minus 2, that's all that you can write. So these are your first 7 entries in the list. Then we list all the rationals that also require, in addition to 0, 1, minus 1, 2, minus 2, that also require 3 or negative 3. We list the rational numbers, that is to say, by complexity. You can say that these are simpler rational numbers because they involve smaller numerator, smaller denominator, and now we're getting to more complicated rational numbers that require either a larger numerator or a larger denominator. So now it's 1/3. Immediately after 1/3, we put its negative, minus 1/3. Then we put 2/3. Then minus 2/3. We increase the numerator. 3 over 3 I don't have to put because it's already included. It's equal to 1. So now we switch. 3 over 1, minus 3 over 1. 3 halves, minus 3 halves. And now we have included all the rational numbers that can be written by using only 0, 1, minus 1, 2, minus 2, 3, and minus 3. Next line will be all the rational numbers that can be written by using 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 3, plus minus 4. So I start with 1/4, minus 1/4. Then you put 2/4, well, it's already in the list. So if you want, you can erase it. You don't have to include it twice. For our purposes, it's not a big problem if you include it twice. All that matters is that every rational eventually makes it to the list. 1/2 on 2/4, the same number appears twice. That's okay, I don't worry about this. Now, these are all the numbers that you can write by using everything up to plus minus 4. And then you go with up to plus minus 5. 5 first in the denominator, 5 in the numerator, and so on. Let's look at some pretty random rational number, 2017 over 580. Is it in the list? Yes? Yes, it is in the list. How can you convince me that it is in the list? If you continue, yes? Very good. If you continue on the row with number 2017, you will see that number. So this will make it, it will appear on row number 2017. Every rational number will make it to the list. So yes, this is in the list. we have a very clear procedure. We have a step-by-step process of what rational number we put in this box every day, and every rational number will appear. We say that the set of rational numbers is countable. This is the first takeaway message from today. You can actually enumerate the rational numbers this way. It was definitely not obvious. There were so many of them, and yet we were able to list them in a sequence. The way we do it is by increasing their complexity. You would agree that 2017 over 580 is a more complex number. It's a more complicated number. It involves larger numerator denominator than two-thirds. That's why two-thirds appears way earlier in the list. Okay, now, this is interesting that you can list them as an infinite sequence, but it is interesting only if I give you an example of a set which is not countable. So far, we have the positive integers, obviously countable, the integers you observed countable, now the rationals are countable. Right now, that's not too exciting for you. I have to give you an example of a set which is not countable, and then this will become interesting. We'll do it slightly later. Okay, real numbers. What is a real number? Let's go down to basics, the foundations of mathematics. What is a real number, yes? Every number that can be written either as a fraction or not as a fraction, that is, technically speaking, it's not wrong, but it's tautological, because you say a real number is a real number that can be written as a fraction or that cannot be written as a fraction. So you're saying either rational or irrational, but we still need to define what type of number it is, what a real number is. What do we call a real number, yes? Doesn't just include the fractions, that's true. So there could be, there are more numbers than the rationals, that's true, yes. But what are they? What types of objects are they? Roots, yes. For example, square root of 2 should be a real number, that's true. But we have to say what a real number is. And then say, look at square root of 2, it is a real number. So you're right, whatever definition we give, square root of 2 should be an example. Yes?
Any number that can be put on the number line.
Any number that can be put on the number line. That's a very, very good answer. That's a geometric way of thinking about the real numbers. The real numbers, you can think of them as the points on a number line. For me, there is no difference between a real number and a point on this line. If you draw a point, it has a name, and this name is a real number. If you have a real number, it has a location, and that location is the corresponding point. So yes, real numbers and points on the line are exactly the same thing. That's a good answer, except it's a little bit of a chicken or egg question. Because now, what is a line? To answer that question is equivalent to figure out what you would call a real number. Real number, real numbers, and points on the line are the same thing, but you have to define one or the other. It is absolutely correct, but it's a little bit chicken or egg. So let's look at this a little bit more, and then we'll avoid that. What is the advantage? The advantage is that you can now draw real numbers. Well, if you draw this isosceles triangle, right angled with legs equal to 1, ancient Greeks discovered the hypotenuse is not a rational number. It's what they call square root of 2. And it is irrational. It cannot be written as a fraction. I hope you know the proof of this. We're not discussing it today. If you don't, look it up. It's a very interesting, very enlightening proof that gives you insights of what the nature of a rational number is. Okay, this way you produce that number, square root of 2. So this is a length of this segment, and you can put it on the real line. You can take this segment, put one end at zero, and the other end, wherever it lands, this is square root of 2. That's what square root of 2 is. It's the length of that hypotenuse. So with this geometric mindset, you can produce real numbers. Very good. But we have this chicken or egg issue. So what is the other, what is another way to define real numbers? If you don't want to think of them, to describe them as points on a line. How else would you describe a real number? Yes? Everything, any triangle that you create, any geometric shape, any line segment that you create, the length will be a real number. But this is that geometric way of describing the real numbers. So this brings us to chicken or egg issues. Let's do a completely algebraic description without line segments, without lines. What is an alternative way to think of real numbers? Yes? So let me repeat the answer. It's every complex number where the imaginary part is zero. It is correct, but to define a complex number, first you need to build upon real numbers. So it is correct, but not what we're looking for. That's right. We're not going to complex numbers today, but let's define a real number. How do you... Have you seen real numbers that are not presented to you as lengths of segments? Any real number that you can write as square root or something, it is naturally the length of something by Pythagorean theorem. But what is an alternative way to describe it, yes? Decimal expansion, very good. Real numbers have infinite decimal expansions. So you can say that a real number is an infinite string or an infinite decimal. Some integer, a is some integer, positive or negative. Think about positive if you wish. Point, the decimal point, and then infinitely many digits extending to the right. B1, B2, B3, and so on. Each bi is a digit. It's an infinite decimal this way, or an infinite string. That's what the real number is. That's a perfectly good algebraic definition. It does not rely on any notion of a line. So if you define real number this way, then you can add numbers by adding digits, starting from the right and following like by some rules, you add the digits. You can multiply real numbers, you can compare real numbers, you can tell which one is less than that. Any two numbers, you can say one is bigger or smaller than the other. So these are your real numbers. And then you can say line basically is all the real numbers. However, we have to be just slightly careful if we define it as an infinite string, because if something finishes with an infinite tail of nines, you can replace these nines by zero and increase by one the previous digit. These are two different strings, but they represent the same real number. So an infinite number is an infinite string, but in some cases, it's kind of rare, but this happens, some cases two different strings can represent the same number. With this convention, that's how we can think about real numbers. For example, now you can produce real numbers very easily without bothering to draw them. 8.57, then 5577, then 3 fives, then 3 sevens, and then you continue with the obvious pattern. This number has some pattern in it. Is it a rational or an irrational number? Yes?
Yeah.
Irrational? Why?
Because I think irrational numbers are numbers that end some
the rational numbers are the ones that are periodic. Something gets repeated. You have some sequence, and it repeats and repeats and repeats, and so on. If it repeats eventually, then this would be a rational number. So therefore, this number is not rational. There is no sequence that gets repeated. This is an example of an irrational real number. You can write this, 5-4, 5-4, 5-4, and so on. Now it repeats itself. It's periodic. And therefore, this is a rational number. Or, most interestingly for us, you can write pretty random digits. You can say 2.84201. You can produce one random digit every day, put it there, one random digit the next day, and so on, and you are in the process of producing a real number. You can have plenty of real numbers, just put digits there. Okay, that's what real numbers are. It is true they are points on the line, but for us, we'll think about them as infinite decimals, infinite strings. Okay, now let's wrap up. The positive integers are contained in the set of integers. There are integers that are not positive integers, like minus 5. Then a larger set of numbers is the set of rational numbers. 2/3 is a rational number, which is not an integer. And all of them are inside the set of real numbers. For us, this will be the largest box today, the set of real numbers. And an example is square root of 2. It's a real number which is not rational. How many of you know a proof of why square root of 2 is not rational? Some of you, but not many. The others, look it up online. It's very enlightening, it's very short. Square root of 2 is not a rational number. Okay, now look at this. Square root of 2 is not rational, but it's not a very complicated number, you'd agree. Why is it not very complicated? Because it is a solution of this equation, x squared minus 2 equals 0. If you plug in, instead of x, you plug in square root of 2, you will get 0. So this is a solution of a very simple equation. It's one of these equations that you solve in school many times. Now let's look at another real number. 7th root of 11. This is also a real number. But it's also not too complicated. It is a solution of that equation, x to the 7th minus 11 equals 0. If you raise beta to the 7th power and subtract 11, you get 0. So there are solutions of these equations. These equations are made out of integers. They have powers of x, x squared or x to the 7th power. They have powers of x, and everything else is integers. So in a way, they are made out of integers. You have real numbers like square root of 2 plus square root of 3. Perfectly good real number. You can think geometrically, square root of 2, one hypotenuse, square root of 3, another hypotenuse, put them right next to each other, you get this square root of 2 plus square root of 3. Is this number, gamma, let's call it gamma, square root of 2 plus square root of 3, is it a solution of some equation like the ones above? Some equation which have only powers of x and integer coefficients. Can you concoct, can you create, can you design an equation where this is a solution? How would you approach that? Yes? Using? Two parabolas. Two variables. Using two variables. Yeah, but here it's a specific explicit number, so we don't need two variables. No. At the end, I want it to be a solution of only of an equation that involves only x, only one unknown. Because this is one number, even though it's made out of two square roots, it's one number. I want it to be a solution of a single equation that involves only x. Can you design such an equation? let's see, on scratch paper, on the right side, on this panel, we start with this number. How can you create an equation that it satisfies, which has no square roots, only integers? What would you do? You have to get rid of the square roots. How would you get rid of these square roots? Yes? Square, okay? Square, gamma square will be 5 plus 2 square root of 6 by your formula for raising to second power. Then what would you do next? Sorry? Get rid of the square root, so bring the 5 to the left, gamma square minus 5, and then to get rid of the square root, you square again. Gamma square minus 5 squared is equal to 4 times 6, 24. And now you just expand. You get gamma to the 4th minus 10 gamma square plus 25, and then you bring the 24 to the left, so it becomes plus 1 equals 0. Notice that gamma satisfies that equation. It satisfies this relation. If you take powers of gamma, namely gamma square and gamma to the 4th in this case, and you put some integer coefficients, you get 0. You can create an equation which is satisfied by gamma. In other words, it's a solution of x to the 4th minus 10x squared plus 1. If instead of x you plug in gamma, you get 0. Okay, so gamma, by taking squares, satisfies that equation. You can imagine, if you write some other real number, which is pretty nasty, maybe third root of something, and inside the third root you may have a fifth root and a seventh root, and then the whole thing plus another tenth root. You can have some pretty nasty numbers that you write in terms of roots. If you raise this to large powers, and keep doing this many times, you raise to a large power, then you bring something to the right, then you raise again, and you keep going, you will get equations. Okay, so all of these numbers are solutions of equations of that type. Two-thirds, let's look at all the rational numbers. Are they also solutions of equations that involve x and have integer coefficients? Yes? Very good, very good. 3x minus 2 equals 0 has that rational number as a solution. Every rational number is a solution of such an equation. Okay, so what happens is, we have this huge set of real numbers. Inside, we listed a few examples of real numbers that are not rational. However, they are all solutions of polynomial equations. These equations are called polynomial equations. They contain only powers of x with integer coefficients. All of these examples that we listed of real numbers are solutions of equations like that. The real numbers that you see in your everyday life, they arise very naturally as solutions of polynomial equations with integer coefficients. All of these are examples. Therefore, bigger than the set of rationals and inside the set of reals, we have this set which consists of all real numbers which are solutions of equations like that. These numbers are examples. And we call these numbers algebraic numbers. And for the purposes of the talk today, we denote them by curly A. The set of all algebraic numbers. The set of all numbers which are solutions of polynomial equations like that. The goal of the talk is to answer this question. Are there real numbers that are not algebraic? Or is it the case that every real number, after you raise it to some powers and after you do some algebraic manipulations, is a solution of a polynomial equation with integer coefficients? Are there real numbers that fall outside of this green shape? Or does the green shape exhaust all the real numbers? That will be our main question. Before we continue, let me just go over some background I hope the contents of this slide are second nature to you, but very quickly I want to review so that we are comfortable with what we mean by polynomial equations. This polynomial equation, very simple, linear equation, has one solution, that's the solution. If I give you this polynomial equation, it's a quadratic equation. It has constant term, coefficient of x squared. What can you say about the number of solutions before doing any calculations? Just, yes? Two solutions? Maximal two, very good. So if you're a lazy mathematician, or just a mathematician, you just say a priori up to two solutions. Maybe no solutions, maybe one solution, maybe two solutions. In this case, there are two solutions. We don't care. Up to two solutions by the quadratic formula. If I give you something cubic, this is a cubic equation of degree 3. It has constant coefficient x, x squared, and x cubed. What can you say about the number of solutions? Yes? Up to 3. And let me just quickly recall the reason. You notice in this case that x1 equals 1 is a solution. If you plug in 1 in place of x, you get 0. Because it is a solution, your polynomial, the expression on the left, factors as x minus 1 times something else. This 1 in the factor corresponds to x1 equal to 1. 1 is a solution, so x minus 1 is a factor. And you're left with something quadratic. Think of degree 2. The polynomial left of degree 2 has up to 2 roots, 2 solutions. So you can get up to 2 more solutions from the second factor. Altogether, indeed, up to 3 solutions. If I give you something of degree 4, by the same argument, it has up to 4 solutions. Something of degree 5, something of degree 12, up to 12 solutions. And non-examples of polynomial equations. 4 to the x equals 16. That's not polynomial. It's an exponential equation because x, it's not that x is raised to a power, it's 4 raised to the power of x. X appears in the exponent. So this is not polynomial. The middle one is not polynomial, because you have x downstairs in the denominator. It's not a polynomial, although if you get rid of the denominator, it will become polynomial, but right now it's not polynomial. Sine x equals 0. How many of you are familiar with the solutions of sine x equals 0? Some of you? Okay. It has infinitely many solutions, and it's not a polynomial equation. Anyway, don't worry about it, it's not. Polynomial equations only have powers of x. Okay, now, come back to our main goal. Namely, to answer this question. Are there real numbers that are not solutions of polynomial equations? That are not algebraic? How many of you, just intuitively, how many of you would say, yes, there are real numbers which are not solutions? Some of you, yes. How many would say no? Every real number, you can create an equation that it solves. A few. Okay, so most of you think yes. Indeed, that's the story. There will be real numbers that are not algebraic, that are not solutions of any equation. The main theorem that we are proving today is the following. First of all, the set of all algebraic numbers, all numbers like that that you can write, which are solutions of equations, this set is countable, just like the rational numbers. Remember, we listed the rational numbers as an infinite sequence. The set of all solutions of all polynomial equations is countable. You can write it as an infinite list. And now, more interestingly, the second takeaway message from the talk today, the set of real numbers is uncountable. There are so many real numbers. You cannot put them in an infinite list. You cannot have a procedure to put one real number in a box every day in a way that every real number eventually appears in that box. The real numbers are way too many. So many, you cannot list them. And because the set of algebraic numbers is countable, you make a list out of it. But this list cannot include all the real numbers. Therefore, there will be real numbers, not algebraic. That's how we are going to prove that there exist real numbers that are not algebraic. So we have to prove these two bullet points. The first one is a slight generalization of the proof that the rationals are countable. We just go to the algebraic numbers. It's just slightly more symbols, slightly more notation, but it's not a new idea. Okay, let's prove that the set of algebraic numbers is countable. For this, let's just have on the screen a polynomial equation looks like this. It has degree n, coefficients an, an minus 1, up to a0. All coefficients are integers. That's our polynomial equation. And curly a is the set of all solutions of all polynomial equations. These are the algebraic numbers. Now I'm going to make a list of all the algebraic numbers. How does that work? Well, first consider all possible polynomial equations, that's a polynomial equation, of degree at most 1, and all coefficients in absolute value up to 1. So the coefficients can only be 0, 1, and minus 1. And the degree can be up to 1. Let's see. How many such polynomial equations are there? Finitely many or infinitely many? Yes? Just the coefficient of x. The coefficient of x can be 0, 1, or minus 1. And constant coefficient, which can also be 0, 1, or minus 1. But they? It's countable, it's finite. The number of such polynomial equations is finite because you have only two coefficients. For the first one, you have three choices. For the second one, you have three choices. You can combine each of these three with each of those three. You can make 9 equations. Out of these 9 equations, you get finitely many solutions. Now you look at all polynomial equations of degree at most 2. Now you erase the degree. And all coefficients that get involved. How many coefficients are involved in a polynomial equation of degree 2? How many coefficients are there? If the degree is 2, yes? No, if the degree is 2, you start with something times x squared, something times x, and then constant term. So how many coefficients? 3 coefficients. Coefficient of x squared, coefficient of x, and constant coefficient. For each of them, you have, as you say, 5 choices. Yes, that's what you said, 5 choices. Each of the coefficients can take 5 values, from minus 2 to 2. They are 5 integers. So you have 3 coefficients. Each of them can take finitely many values. Altogether, you have finitely many such polynomial equations. And each of them has how many solutions? Finitely many, up to 2. So here, I have listed finitely many numbers. Then we continue. All polynomial equations of degree at most 3, they will have 4 coefficients of x cubed, of x squared, of x, and constant coefficient, 4 coefficients. Each of these 4 coefficients can be minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, or 3. So you have finitely many again. Each of them has finitely many solutions. And you list them on the third row. And you keep going. Then all of them of degree at most 4 and all absolute values at most 4. This is a perfectly good procedure to make a list that's an infinite list. Are the solutions of this equation in the list? That's a pretty random equation. Are the solutions in the list? Yes or no? Yes. How can you convince me that yes, they are in the list? Yes? At some point, namely at which point? 980. Once you get to line 980, then this is a polynomial of degree at most 980, and all coefficients in absolute value at most 980. So this is one of the polynomials that we're talking about on line 980. And its roots are listed on line 980. Are they in the list? Yes. Look at this. Are the solutions of this polynomial in the list? If yes, where? Yes? On the line number 7001, you will see the solutions of this, because the degree is up to 7001, and all coefficients do not exceed in absolute value to 7001. So this is one of the polynomials on line 7001. All of its roots are there on this line. Yes, they are in the list. Are the solutions of any polynomial equation in the list? Yes. You just look at the largest among the degree and all the coefficients in absolute value. And on this largest, you look at the largest of all of these, on this row, you see them. Therefore, all the algebraic numbers are in the list. Where is square root of 2 in that list? Square root of 2 was solution of x squared minus 2. On which row are we going to see square root of 2? Yes? Second row. How about square root of 2 plus square root of 3? On which row? Do you remember? Yes? On the 10th row, because we had x to the 4 minus 10x squared plus 1. So every number that we have seen is definitely in this list. The set of algebraic numbers is countable. Where are we? Here. We considered these algebraic numbers inside the real numbers, and we proved that the set of algebraic numbers is countable. Our proof did not involve a new idea besides what we already did for the rationals. We listed the rationals by complexity of numerator and denominator, and we did a modification of this for the algebraic numbers. So it's not really a new idea, it's just a slight, we call it a generalization, an adaptation of the proof for the countability of the rationals. Now comes the second punchline of the talk. The set of real numbers, on the other hand, is uncountable. I'm going to prove now that it is not possible to make an infinite list that contains all the real numbers. And that will make the fact that Q was countable interesting. And the fact that the algebraic numbers are countable, interesting. So many real numbers, you cannot fit them in an infinite list. Even though your list is allowed to be infinite, you cannot put them all inside. Here is how we are going to prove it. In fact, I will prove that the set of real numbers in the interval 0, 1 is uncountable. Already in this interval, there are so many real numbers, you cannot fit them in an infinite list. Okay, we'll prove it. Proof. Consider any infinite list of real numbers. Take an infinite list. Let's call it alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 4, and so on. For a certain reason, I prefer to put them vertically. So take an infinite list of real numbers. What do we have to prove that will imply the statement that the real numbers cannot be put in an infinite list? Yes? Very good. We have to prove that not all real numbers in this interval are in the list. So we will exhibit a real number in that interval which is not in the list. Any list. You start with any list. I have no control on the list, and we are going to prove that there exists a real number outside of that list. To prove this, we have to dig in deep into the nature of real numbers. We have to use what the real numbers are. To prove something like this, it's a statement about real numbers. It's not true about rationals. So we have to use what the real numbers are. That's why we were having this discussion, what are the real numbers? If we don't understand that, we have no chance to prove this. Okay, you said that real numbers are infinite decimals. So let's say, because now they're between 0 and 1, all of them start with 0 point something. So let's say 0 point, and then for alpha 1, I write A11, A12, A13, and so on. These are not 11, 12, 13, 14. These are what we call double indices. 11 means the first digit of alpha 1. A12 means the second digit of alpha 1. For example, A34 means the fourth digit of alpha 3. It's a table of numbers. That's why they have two indices. The first index indicates the row, and the second index indicates the column. Okay, so these are all the digits. We write the numbers in terms of their digits. That's what real numbers are. They are infinite strings. They are infinite strings, infinite decimals. Consider, now I'm going to write down a number and say that this number is not in the list. I'll consider a certain number beta and claim that it's outside of the list. Any list will omit that number. Well, given that list, it will omit that number beta. Any list will omit a certain number. How do we construct beta? Now we have to construct something outside of the list. Well, let's look carefully at the first digit of the first member of the sequence. Alpha 1, I don't care about its other digits, just look at its first digit in red on the screen, A11. How would you choose the first digit of beta? Yes? Has to be different. Let's choose the first digit of beta, let's call it B1, to be different from A11. Whatever the first digit of alpha 1 is, I choose something else. So now beta and alpha 1 have different first digits. Then we go to alpha 2. Let's say the second digit of alpha 2 in green is A22. Look at the second digit of alpha 2. How would you choose the second digit of beta? Yes? Different. Let's choose the second digit of beta to be different from the second digit of alpha 2. B2 not equal to A22. Then we go to the third digit of alpha 3 in blue. Whatever it is, it's one of the digits. By the way, remember, all of these are digits. 0, 1, up to 9. There are 10 choices for each of them. If there are 10 choices for A11, I have 9 left for B1. I have plenty of choices. There are 10 possibilities for what A33 can be. So I have 9 possibilities for, then let's choose B3. Any digit different from A33. So now beta and alpha 3, they differ in their third digit. Maybe the third digit of beta coincides with the third digit of alpha 1. I don't care. Beta and alpha 1 already differ in their first digit. Then we go to the fourth digit, A44. The fourth digit specifically of alpha 4. I choose B4, the fourth digit of beta, to be anything different from that. Now, I have a question. Are we sure that beta is different from alpha 1? Yes, but there is a little technicality. Remember that you can have two different strings which represent the same number. What if A11 was 7, all of the other digits were 99999, and B1 is 8, and then all the other Bs are 0. Remember that 0.7 and then 99999 is equal to 0.8 and then zeros. So we just have to watch out for that. That's a very small, very technical detail. Don't worry, we can avoid it. Let's choose BI never to be 0 or 9. then this never happens. Two different strings can represent the same number only if one of them finishes with infinitely many nines, the other finishes with a tail of zeros. But this way, we are sure beta is different from alpha 1 because they differ in the first digit. It's different from alpha 2, they differ in the second digit. It's different from alpha 3, they differ in the third digit. It's different from every term in the sequence. It's outside of the list. It's not in the list. Of course, it's you cannot keep producing it that way, because if you keep building one digit at a time, you'll never finish. You have to say, all at once, we choose bi to be different from aii. Don't worry about this. We constructed a number outside of the list. So if you go to our picture, the set of algebraic numbers, just like the rationals, is countable. You can list it. But that infinite list cannot include all the real numbers. The real numbers cannot be put in a list. Therefore, there are real numbers which are not algebraic. We answered that question. And our proof is what we call a non-constructive proof. We proved that there are real numbers not algebraic without explicitly exhibiting a single such number. When you prove that there are real numbers which are not rational, you say square root of 2. Look at square root of 2. It's a real number, but it's not rational. That's an explicit proof. For us, we saw that we proved that there are real numbers that are not algebraic, but didn't exhibit a single one. Does anyone know a real number which is not algebraic? Yes? Pi. Pi is a real number, it's not algebraic. There is no polynomial equation satisfied by pi. However, it's much more difficult to prove that pi, a specific real number, is not algebraic. It's much easier to prove that there exist real numbers, not algebraic, by this countability. The two takeaway messages: the rationals are countable, the reals are not. You cannot fit them in an infinite list. Thank you.